Dr. Cavazza, talk to us about the significance of the president's visit to the United States in terms of the context and the timing. We just came from the largest Balikatan exercise, and just days ago, a Philippine Coast Guard vessel had another incident with a China Coast Guard ship. Of course, this visit was planned months ahead or way ahead, but how crucial has this meeting become at this point?
Right. I must say that the bilateral meeting of President Marcos Jr. in Washington with President Biden is pivotal for the two allied countries. For the Philippines, this is the way of Marcos Jr.'s time to reverse and rewrite the Philippines' foreign policy from his predecessor's pivot to China. It will be a momentous opportunity also for President Marcos to leverage Manila's economic and security cooperation with Washington. And I believe that the details of the strengthened alliance would definitely impact the region's geopolitical landscape, since China is a superpower in waiting, or perhaps would remain the region's resident power. And of course, given the situation that we had with the China Coast Guard recently, I think these are the things that we have to patch up with that with Beijing. And of course, we've seen that the Philippines has risen as a middle power in the region, and that the two superpowers are craving to be on the side of Manila. And this will be Washington's way of thanksgiving to Manila, given that, of course, they sided Manila sided with Washington, and also has allowed the expansion of the ETCA sites in the Philippines.
Mm-hmm. And we're just getting word, Dr. Cavazza, from that meeting that the U.S. President Joe Biden reaffirmed the U.S.'s, quote, ironclad commitment in the defense of the Philippines, including the South China Sea. How important are these words coming from the U.S. President himself in that one-on-one meeting with the Philippine President Marcos?
Well, basically, it seems like Washington is happy on the transformation of the Philippines right now, given that the foreign policy is geared towards Washington's favor. We know for a fact that it took time for Washington to reclaim its place in the region, given that, of course, there was a crucial point in the previous administration where, of course, we tried to pivot with China. This time around, the favor is with Washington. But it's going to be a hedging partnership, given that, of course, we cannot get rid of China. China is inevitable in this equation, and Washington is a good balancer also in this equation. So, in other words, we are being lured by these two countries. The Philippines is attractive by these two regional superpowers right now. So it's also on the favor of the Philippines right now.
Mm-hmm. Now, in response to that statement, President Marcos said, and I quote, "It is only natural for the Philippines to look to its sole treaty partner in the world to strengthen and redefine the relationship that we have and the roles that we play in the face of those rising tensions that we see now around the South China, Asia Pacific, and Indo-Pacific region." Is this a clear signal from your point of view, Dr. Cavazza, on where the president and the Philippines stand amid the growing tensions in the region?
Right. I think the President Marcos has learned a lot from the previous administrations back during the Aquino down to Duterte. You know, I think the most important here is that the Philippines has learned how to deal with its meek and weak foreign policy. It's trying to rectify right now. At the same time, we are modernizing the armed forces, and we are no longer ignorant of the geopolitical changes that is happening in our own backyard. I think these are two important things that we have to consider. The mere fact that Washington has pronounced these words and President Marcos has accepted reality, we have to really iron our commitment to these treaty alliance we had with the United States. But we have to review the Mutual Defense Treaty and the Visiting Forces Agreement, because those military agreements, when it was signed, the military and geopolitical scenarios were different. Today, what we are seeing right now is a mighty China that is rising in the Indo-Pacific region, and it is trying to perhaps replace the United States, or perhaps challenge the power of the United States in the Indo-Pacific.
But with this visit, Dr. Cavazza, what do you think is the message that the president is sending to China?
The message that we are seeing right now is that the Manila is committed to its treaty alliance with Washington, and at the same time, we wanted to tell to China that we subscribe to maritime rules-based norms and to institutional norms. And also at the same time, we have to consider that since Washington is a treaty ally, it could also be an economic partner in the region. So these are very crucial for the Philippines, for the in a way that we are doing a balancing, delicate balancing act as of the moment. So it sends also a signal to China that we could of course nurture our role as a middle power for these two superpowers, in which case we can deal with them in a very delicate way.
In the reverse, Dr. Cabalza, how crucial, how important is the position of the Philippines in the region for the United States? We've had a recent study by Lowy Institute, an Australian-based think tank, saying that in the region, only two countries, Singapore and the Philippines, remains to be highly influenced by the U.S. The other countries, China has a greater influence over them. So how important is the Philippines to the U.S. at this point?
Right. Although there are two countries, right? I must agree with you. The Philippines and Singapore are the only two Southeast Asian countries. The things that the United States influence is paramount in the region. But at the same time, if you ask countries around Asia, they still trust the United States in terms of its capability to balance its power with China. But with the question that you asked me, how do we leverage on this one, given that, of course, China is expanding its military and economic clout in the region, we have to consider that as a middle power now, together with Singapore, the role of middle powers is to bridge peace and order in the region. The mere fact that we are engaging with Washington right now, we believe in the rules-based norms, we believe in international laws, and these are the things that we have to consider and tell it to China that as a resident power in the region, it must subscribe to these maritime rules-based norms and to international legal instruments.
And Dr. Cabalza, the top priority in this visit of the president to the U.S. are the military cooperation agreements between the U.S. and the Philippines. Now, President Marcos earlier said they'll look at how else the visiting forces agreement and the mutual defense treaty with the U.S. can evolve. From your point of view, is there anything that needs to change? You did say we need to update them in terms of the context, but are there provisions that we need to include? And should that also include cybersecurity provisions as recommended by one legislator?
Definitely, things are changing right now, especially that the form of warfare would be different in case of any eventuality in our own backyard and in the region. We have to consider now that cyber warfare, cognitive warfare, this time around we are seeing competition on political and economic warfare between China and the U.S. These are two leading economies in the world, two powerful countries in the world. So in case of eventuality, a shooting war in our region, it's going to be the most expensive war that we will be seeing and the most dangerous war in the region. So these are different things. And for sure, once a war would happen, definitely the order and the techniques and the doctrines would be different because they would be imploring different forms of hybrid warfare, which we have not seen in the past. So it's going to be a different world war scenario that we will be seeing. Of course, because of these different scenarios that we will be seeing, definitely the Mutual Defense Treaty and the visiting forces must evolve. If you remember, the biggest balikatan exercises we have had with the United States brought us amphibious warfare, and it exposed the Philippines to external defense, in which we're trying to shift from internal security operation to territorial defense. This is something new for us. So I think we are preparing our own military to become naval ready. So these are different scenarios that we will be seeing. And it seems like the military instruments that we had with the United States must be reviewed and must be changed in some ways.
And Dr. Kubasa, these military agreements do not come without opposition. There are faith-based groups in the U.S. who recently came out with a letter calling on the U.S. government to abstain from entering into new military agreements that will, quote, contribute to human rights violations in the Philippines. Are they justified in taking that route in calling attention to human rights abuses? That's what they call persistent and worsening human rights issues in the Philippines.
I don't think this is what Washington is seeing in the Philippines. I know that Washington is happy with the kind of the direction of the foreign policy and how Marcos Jr. is handling the human rights abuses or human rights violations in the Philippines. So I think this is like a nuance to the current and revived bilateral relationship of the Philippines and the United States right now. I know Washington is happy with how Manila is handling our foreign policy as of the moment. So it will not hinder the relationship between the Philippines and the United States.
How high is human rights, though, in the agenda between the two leaders? Because there was mention in the joint statement about respect for human rights and the rule of law, but there are no details there, unlike with respect to the West Philippine Sea, navigation and all that. This one, it's silent, except for that mention of respect for human rights.
Yeah, well, we have to, based from our observation right now, unlike in the previous administration where we have seen prominent events of the war on drugs this time around, that is not the banner policy of the current administration. I think the banner policies of the administration right now are on food security, infrastructure, climate change, and of course the military alliance that we have with the United States. So definitely human rights would be discussed, but it's not in the top priority right now, given that of course Washington is happy with our with its relationship with Manila right now, and Washington thinks that of course we know that the US of course is a main advocate of human rights worldwide. They think that Marcos Jr. is handling this situation in a positive way.
And lastly, Dr. Kabalza, before we let you go, what would be the likely tangible outcome of this visit? What are you anticipating in terms of military agreements, financial assistance?
Well, for me, I think this time around that Washington is trying to revert its alliance with the United States, with the Philippines, basically by offering economic and security cooperation with the Philippines. We have to consider that, of course, in the previous months, China has been very active in its economic warfare with the United States. So I think this time around, they will be talking about more investments in the Philippines, particularly on energy, agriculture, and infrastructure. So these are things we wanted to have with the United States, given that, of course, the competition now goes with political and economic warfare in our region and in the Philippines.
All right, Andano, thank you so much for sharing your insights with us this morning, Dr. Chester Kabalza.
Thank you very much.